Hey everyone, this is Trouffman from the HWBOT World Tour 2016 here in Latin America. We are in Sao Paulo in Brazil, and I am joined tonight with Peter. Hey Peter.
Hello, how are you doing?
Great, and yourself?
I'm doing quite well. We're nearing the end of the evening, so...
Can't wait for me to go sleep, right? So this show will be, it's a little bit in advance, and we will be doing that for 1 hour, and we will be talking, we call that the Tech Talk Q&A, and basically you can ask us any question that you have, either on Twitter, at OverClocking-TV, or using the hashtag HWT2016, and we will basically discuss on some of the, different topics that pass by, we want to discuss and so on. It's actually quite open. So if you're actually joining us from Twitch, you can always tune in on the live chats and ask us any questions. I want to say hi to Jumper118 that is a regular here, and LulKOC from France for sticking around. Thanks guys for being here. And if you have any question for tonight or any topics you want us to discuss, that will be the time for it. So Peter, let's start first by, checking what we did today and did or not did actually. We are here at the HWBOT World Tour 2016. It's the first stop of the season. And today we had the workshop. And I think the last time we checked, there was 51 person that did submit score in the qualifier. So that actually means there's even more people that did took the workshop, right?
Yep, that is correct. So 51 people so far submitted to the qualifier for the amateurs. And I think our previous record was it about 100 in Gamers Assembly? Maybe only like around 75 in Gamers Assembly submitted to the competition, and 100 people joined in the workshop. So I think we're already nearing our previous best from last year in one day.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's actually quite insane. We had some of the, a few misadventure per se. We had some leak from the ceiling and we had to move away the stuff. But that was actually quite a fast reaction that we had to have at this very moment, because there were so many people doing the workshop that we have to find a solution for that.
Yeah, and in the end, we didn't really solve that much. It was just put it a bit more on the
Let's
side.
Let's move it on the side.
Yeah. I think overall the workshop has been going very, very well. Very little amount of problems. Actually, no issues with the hardware whatsoever.
That is good, especially when you have a lot of people that have no clue about doing all these things and changing a lot of the settings, and everything still work after that. So that was great.
Yeah, and we know from LAN ETS and Gamers Assembly last year that problems do occur, even if you're just running on all-in-one water cooling.
Yeah. It's always a bit tricky to find the right settings and the right framework. But so far, the workshop at the HWBOT World Tour, it's quite mature, because we know exactly how to mount the PC, we know exactly how we want that to scale. So do you think maybe one day we can do more than what we have here today, like the five systems at once?
I mentioned this to Timothy already as well. I think given the current format, if we have if we have, let's say, instead of 5 PCs, we have 15 PCs, and instead of one teacher at the same time, we have 3 teachers at the same time. I think at an event like Campus Party, we could easily have a workshop with over 500 people who come and compete in a competition easily. Yeah.
Damn.
But for that, we need to have more manpower. We need to have more hardware.
Perfect. Well, talking about today as well, did you took the time to a little bit visit the Campus Party?
I haven't. Well, I've been walking around for sure, but you have visited most of the stuff, right?
Well, most of the stuff. We actually did pass and did a quick video with it, but that's pretty much it. And we do hope actually that the network would be stable enough for tonight to not have any cuts on the live show. So if you have anything, just let us know on the live chat as well. What was the? I will ask one more question about the workshop. What was the most interesting for you regarding the people that did attend the workshop?
Most impressive personal achievement, or
the personality of the people that were here. Did someone just like stand out of the crowd and things like, oh yeah, I want to maybe do more, or these guys you maybe know that it will be more at HWBOT in the next few months?
Let's mention two separate things. First of all, I think I'm very not surprised, but I'm very happy to see that Alex, nickname is Dark Venom, is doing so well in teaching people how to do the overclocking. He's been at it all day basically, and he seems to be, you know, enjoying talking to people about overclocking, and people enjoy talking or listening to him as well, which is very interesting. And then a second group of people, or a second topic, is that a group of people, after they join in the qualifiers, they pass by our area here. It's a little bit away from the workshop area, and they were asking us, okay, where can we train more? Where can we find a system where we can practice our overclocking even more?
And you give them incentive for that?
I told them to go online and read some guides.
Look on Google. Google knows everything. Well, I guess there was one of the questions on the live chat. Maybe from Gikot. Maybe I didn't pronounce correctly. The question was way too vague. Like, what is the best processor for overclocking on water cooling? Okay, let's say you are a beginner. What should you start first if you want to try overclocking?
It's a very difficult question, in a sense that every processor will be better on water cooling than it is on air cooling. I think the major advantage of water cooling are it's more silent than active high active cooling. So I think that's the major advantage of custom water cooling. You also have lower temperatures, which generally gives you a wider range of overclocking capabilities.
So to answer the question directly, there's no best CPU for overclocking and water cooling. But water cooling is always better than just air cooling, the regular one. It's always better than the red box.
Exactly. The red box is a French term, the default stock cooler.
Yeah. Yeah. Even though actually for the workshop we do use some of the stock cooler, and people, I'm actually impressed about the score that people can reach, especially with the temperature here in Sao Paulo.
It's a low profile stock cooler, and the guys are running XTU at 4.6 gigahertz with a G3258.
I'm quite surprised, to be honest. When I was saying, like, oh yeah, wait, 4.4 if you are lucky, and then some guys, like, actually it's 4.6 benching. Well, great. Peter, let's talk a little bit about, like, the hardware news and so on. And we had a discussion off live with Fabio from Techmundo earlier today, and we were actually discussing about AMD and the stand that AMD is, because they announced new CPU for the end of the year, the one based on the Zen architecture, and they announced new GPU as well, new GPU architecture around the Polaris architecture. And we were discussing that, no, the crowd, the target crowd is not exactly the same as the one that Intel will be doing. So can you sum up the discussion that we had with Fabio offline, and then we can discuss a little bit more about that?
Mm-hmm. So one of the topics that we, one of the first topics that we discussed about AMD was AMD's general perception in the market. So I asked Fabio from Brazil, knowing that the wages in Brazil are not that high, and you know it's hardware isn't generally fairly expensive, how do people think about AMD in Brazil? And as it turns out, actually, people are not that positive about AMD, in a sense that they would say that it would be too hot and Intel has higher performance, which is, I mean, and also AMD has higher power consumption, which, I mean, it's true to a certain degree, but not in a sense that you should overlook any AMD CPU because of that reason. And he mentioned that in discussions with the AMD Brazil representative, they know, they are aware of this at AMD, and they kind of want to change that image. On the same topic, I had a discussion with some of our Indonesian overclocking friends, and they mentioned that the marketing in Indonesia is a bit different, where the general audience in Indonesia would think of AMD CPUs or AMD APUs as the gaming solutions, whereas Intel CPUs would be more of the workstation, the creative.
The enterprise and the creative side.
Yeah, exactly. So if you want to do work, you use an Intel. If you want to do gaming, you use an AMD CPU. And it's very interesting to see how in the minds of people, these two brands live together. You know, you have the minds of people where Intel has the highest performance, which is, you know, you can't argue about that. Intel has all the performance records. And then, you know, whether or not AMD is regarded as using too much power and too much heat, or actually being, if you tweak around a little bit with an AMD APU, you can have a very, very performant low-end to mainstream gaming system. There's no real problem with it. But it's interesting to see that AMD sort of is now ended up in this situation where they have the perception against them.
Yeah, that's actually sad, because this is the worst part to remove, because that takes ages to actually remove that. We saw that with MSI in the past 10 years. 10 years ago, people were saying that MSI was not reliable and so on. And nowadays, they're being looked at one of the most trusted manufacturer of mainboard in VGA. Yeah. And that was a long way for them, and it took years and years and years for that. And even online, sometimes you still see like, oh no, don't buy this brand, or don't buy this kind of motherboard, because, and basically it's like, oh, because they suck, or because they always die and so on. But it's not true anymore, and it literally took years.
Yeah,
for them.
Correct. Yeah. And so we moved on the conversation to talk about some of the numbers that we see at HWBOT, and some of these numbers are my first CPU was an AMD CPU, and I think everyone, whether or not you buy AMD or you buy Intel, you want AMD to do very well, because ultimately, if AMD CPUs are very competitive, then maybe we'll see a bit more affordable on the Intel and on the Intel side, right? So we were talking about some of the evolutions that we see on HWBOT, and bear in mind again, HWBOT is a platform for performance enthusiasts and overclockers. It's already a very specific part of the market, so it doesn't represent the general market. But we do see that even on the AMD side of things, where AMD enthusiasts are being looked at, AMD is not doing that well, and I think that should be much more of a concern than the current maybe not so great solutions they have. The fact that they don't have people vouching for their products, in a sense that a real performance enthusiast would, I think that is a big issue.
And there was a good comment from Jumper118 on the live chat as well, that the Phenom 2 platform is actually quite cheap for someone that wants to start overclocking. The overclock, it's fun to overclock with it, it's quite easy, and it's quite cheap to acquire as well. So yeah, it's actually crazy, especially with Intel locking most of the SKU, and you cannot overclock them, while on the AMD it was always quite open pretty much.
Yep. And that's also surprising to me that, you know, AMD has everything fully unlocked, and yet still they're not really able to capture the interest of the performance enthusiasts.
Yeah, I hope that one day they will come back, so there's going to be more competitions, and actually that will be better for us customer in the end, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So I guess you had some screens, some screenshot and information.
Yeah, this is some of the stuff that I've been looking at in on HWBOT side. Let's see if you can actually get this up. So this is mapping over time since 2006. How many AMD overclockers there are at HWBOT, and how active these overclockers are at HWBOT. So basically, what you can see here is the AMD enthusiast community at HWBOT. These are people who have an AMD CPU and then decide, you know, I want to overclock it, and I also want to share online with other people how high my overclock is. I want to share my results with the rest of the overclocking community. And we can see that in 2014 and 2015, the AMD overclocking community is sort of stabilized at a fairly low point, a point that is below what we saw in 2007 or 2008. Again, this effect, this is not from Intel customers. Intel buyers have no effect on this chart. This is just people who use AMD. And
so it's completely out of any other influence of others in terms of like percentage of use, etc., right?
Yeah, exactly. So for example, we see in near the end of 2010, there was almost 1,000 AMD overclockers sharing their overclocking results on HWBOT, and now we're slightly below 400, which is a massive drop in a time span of 4 years. And Jumper118 on the chat is hinting towards it already. Bulldozer killed it. In a sense, yes. In a sense, no. For sure, Bulldozer wasn't really a great processor.
Well, it was not as expected. Yeah. It was not as expected, and it came at a very difficult time as well.
Yeah, exactly. But still, you would expect that, you know, AMD fans would still get on board and still push these CPUs. But I think this is much more of a problem for AMD not building their core enthusiasts, the people who go and buy their CPU and not just, you know, be enthusiastic about the CPU that they bought, but also be so enthusiastic that they customize that CPU to say, I don't want to run your default frequency. I will spend time and energy on configuring your product the way I want to have it configured.
Yeah, that's actually sad because you can do it. You have everything you can to afford for that. So always keep in mind, these numbers are just from a very niche target of people that are the extreme users and the enthusiast user that actually do get the product for a benchmarking purpose. So that's not representing any sales from AMD. That's not representing any sales or incentive or any arrangement with the e-tailer, etc. It's just based on the HWBOT data that you guys gather with the database of all the scores of the benchmark.
Yep, exactly. So another table that we compiled was, historically speaking, which are the most popular AMD processors for performance enthusiasts. And we can see that the list is sort of dominated by the Phenom 2 range of CPUs. So you have a Phenom 2, both the X4 and the X6. Then you have the Sempron in there as well. You have one X2 in there. In general, what you don't have is an APU, which is, you know, AMD's been pushing the APUs for a very long time. And only three FX CPUs. None of them are the FX9000 series. If we look at Intel, for example, in this list, we would see a 2600K, but we'd also see the 4770K, the Haswell CPU, or we'd see even the Skylake CPU already popping up in terms of most popular CPUs. We'd see the 980X, the Govtron 980X, pop up in this list as well, which is a $1,000 CPU. So the difference between where Intel buyers are going to in terms of what are the most popular processors and AMD is very, very different. You know, AMD, you have a Sempron 140 in there, which is 20 euros at this point, and yeah, none of the latest technologies.
So can we say, because we can still see like by number of users, like the Athlon 64 3000 still in there and so on. Can we say that the top high enthusiasts of AMD users, user base, were not early adopter when they came out, or they kind of lose faith in what they could be doing with the CPUs?
I'm sure that the Athlon 64 is just, I mean, the 3000 Venice was just a super popular CPU.
Yeah, it was almost everyone I know had one at some point.
Yeah, exactly. So with Intel, you also see the Q6600 and the i7-920 in there. So seeing one older generation CPU in this chart is not unexpected. What is unexpected is that you don't see a A10 APU in there, or the FX9000 or something like that.
So all the one that we're actually pushing quite much for it. Do you think the change with the FX branding name, so they dropped the FX branding name and then a few years after they brought it back, you think that could have affected this group of power users?
I don't think so. They brought the FX back with Bulldozer, and that was just a problem to begin with. I don't think the FX had a really big impact on this. It is pretty interesting that the FX is not in any of these, if any of these are, not even the FX 55 or FX 53, 57, sorry. Then again, those CPUs were from before HWBOT started gathering data at this level.
There was pretty much no data gathering, no central point of gathering this data.
We should maybe ask FutureMark if they can provide some information or some extra information on this.
If they still have it, if they are craving it or not, I don't know actually.
They should have all their data still, I hope.
Do you have any other information regarding this this AMD discussion?
We have one more chart, which is the most popular CPUs in Q4.
And Q4 and again, from 2015.
Yeah, exactly. So last quarter. And here you can see a couple more FX 8000 and 9000 CPUs, as well as one APU pop-up. Interestingly enough, you still see a Phenom 2 as well, which you know, goes to show that still in this list, you'll see not only a very old CPU pop-up, but also still the Sempron, still an FX 4000 CPU.
There's one thing as well, the Phenom X4964 Black Edition. I remember that this one was launched and AMD was targeting extreme overclockers, so they sent that CPUs and gathered, like, I think there was 8 or 9 different overclockers around the world to actually overclock that one extreme for the launch. So maybe that's, you know, like the Black Edition was seen as like an a special CPU for this market target. So that's maybe why we still see it in this chart, because that's the user that will be the most active on the HWBOT as well.
The Phenom 2 X4 and X6 are actually two very good processors. I mean, there's no arguing with that. I think, yeah, that's the only one I can share. This is the overall market share, but that's a story that everyone knows. Since we started collecting data, AMD has been at 20% roughly.
Among this specific target of market target of futures.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Peter. That's some very useful information right there. There's something we could discuss in a complete other show. That's the rise of the SoC and the Qualcomm. Share on it. Of course, before that, the cell phone were not that mainstream with Modify and so on, and nowadays it's actually much more easier to do the modification on that. Do you want to add anything else, or we can move to the next topic?
Well, no, the main point of looking at that data is that I really hope that, considering that AMD's message for Zen is that they want to go back in competing on the desktop, I really hope that they take into consideration that they need to start building a performance enthusiast community. Starting number one is by giving Distilt, who's a Finnish overclocker, all the tools he needs to provide the performance enthusiast with tools they need to overclock. Like, for example, we have a thread.
Why this guy especially?
we have a thread in our forum where some overclockers are sharing their 3DMark Firestrike APU results on Kaveri. And what's very important with the IGP is that you tune your memory. The guys who are trying to get the best Firestrike score, these people, they bought the APU, they said, I'm not satisfied with the performance that is. I will spend time and effort trying to fine-tune your product so I get the absolute most performance, and I'll also try to find other people online and start talking about this. They were looking for a software application to tune the memory timings in the operating system at runtime, and AMD's Overdrive software tool isn't really compatible. So you can change the memory timing, but you will drop in efficiency.
So it's actually counterproductive.
Yeah, and AMD doesn't have any application that will allow Kaveri and Godavari users to really max out their CPU. There's no such thing. So you need to have those performance enthusiasts to, you know, talk about how to optimize your product. They're the first adopters. They're the front line of any of the new releases.
And especially if they get the right tools and start to put some good results and good feedback on it, that will, although make other people jump into it. Like maybe other people that would have bought the CPU or would not even think about it before and just say, oh yeah, now I can do that, so I want to try. It could be fun, so I can buy it. Like for example, I didn't bought the Raspberry Pi before, but when I knew I could overclock it, I just bought one. I still haven't used it, but I bought one. Maybe not the best example, but well. So anyway, for the customer in the end, that would be very interesting if AMD is doing a big comeback with the Zen and Polaris architecture. I can't wait to see the first sample and to see the complete platform to be launched, because that's going to be a complete new platform as well. Peter, you want to jump to the next topic?
Let's jump to the next topic.
Okay, so yesterday we did talk a little bit about DIY and modding with Timothée, and the main reason is because behind us there was like some case modding exposition and so on. For you, Peter, does it look like car racing for you? Like if you have a big car, a nice car, but you have a crap engine inside, do you think that's going to be bad as a mod, or a mod is completely complete when it's also overclocked?
I agree with that. I think that there's a lot of focus on case modding lately, and a lot of the case mods that have come out are absolutely amazing. Like the level of quality and the build quality is gone up significantly. Sadly enough, and this is something that we see at Computex trade shows as well, sadly enough, a lot of the hardware inside is not that high-end. And also, none of the hardware is running at the highest performance that it could run. And the argument basically goes that, you know, if you have a Lamborghini-looking car or a Ferrari-looking car, beautiful car, looks powerful.
And you have a leather engine inside?
Yeah, what's the point, you know? If you have a massive water cooling system in your case and you're not running 5 gigahertz, what?
It looks cool.
Yeah. Like, just like your Ferrari just humbles along at 80 kilometers an hour. No, I understand the argument, yeah.
Because I do actually think that at least should be overclocked a little bit. Okay, you don't want to overclock it crazy, because, okay, it's always a pain in the ass when you have hard tubing, when you need to mount the system, etc. But you can just pre-test everything before and then put that in the system after and do the modding there. But yeah, I do think that like the system inside, the look is an important part, of course, of modding. That's the main argument. But I do think also that the performances that you can get from the system in the finished product is also important for that.
Yeah. And we have to, I mean, most of the really good looking cars are also have a strong engine. You know, you never see a BMW high-end design on their, you know, slowest car. No. The fastest car has the nicest design.
Well, there's a Jumper 118 that said on the live chat, I said that if a PC looks like it isn't going fast enough. Yeah, that's for the people that don't use case at all.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you think that this modding trend could arrive in overclocking with people like trying to have a cuter bench table or pay more attention to how they insulate for extreme overclocking and so on? Because it always looked quite messy in the past.
Maybe. I don't know. I think overclocking and case modding are two separate fields. There's a certain overlap, but overclocking or competitive overclocking and extreme overclocking ultimately is about getting the fastest performance. And then we're not talking about a smooth looking case or anything like that, or lights around everywhere. It's like drag racing. Those cars, they sort of look nice from far, but up close they look very messy as well.
Yeah, it's a lot of people use drag racing as to explain overclocking. Yeah, that could be a way. Water cooling trend so far. Do you like hard tubing?
Can be nice, yeah.
But if you have to mount one of the water cooling system in a case, okay. Imagine, because I know that's not gonna happen anytime soon. Imagine you have to mount a computer in a case. We're going quite far from that. Would you use like regular tubing or hard tubing?
It really depends, I guess. I don't It's very difficult for me to think about a PC inside a case. Are you talking about a notebook?
Oh yeah, true. You're using a notebook now.
It's
oh, actually,
a server,
talking,
right?
Talking about water cooling notebooks, we did share on the OCTV page. I think that was one guy from Thailand that did a modification of his like small Dell notebook and put a water cooling on it. It's completely like it's not quite useful, but it looks so well done. So I'm trying to find back the I will try to find back the image for you guys right after that. Anyway, Peter, do you want to discuss something about like the modding? Where do you think this is going? Do you think that's the trend with the modding and everyone is talking about like, oh yeah, we need to take care of the modders and the makers and so on?
It's hard to say. I don't really have an opinion. I should, before I try and predict the future, I should learn a bit more about it, I think. I think it's very interesting. It's good that the case modders are being treated like they are right now. As I said, the quality of work has gone up dramatically in the past couple of years, so that's nice.
I found back the picture I was talking about. So yeah, it's actually nice that these people are actually now being taken care of, and the build quality of most of the system are impressive as well. I have to admit, it's. I did actually modding before I jumped to overclocking like 15 years ago, and it was ugly as really bad, but it was fun. And then I sure. built up some water cooling stuff.
I think across the room here, there's a guy who has a PC in mineral oil, but he also put a bottle of Jack Daniels inside, where I thought it was, you know, that guy has life figured out.
And it's like the race PC. It's not the PC Master Race, but I think it's just the same group for here in Brazil. Okay, I found back the picture from that small notebook being water cooled. So that was pretty much how it looked so far. So it's not quite useful for a notebook, but it looked quite, you know, quite finished and so on. It's of course like completely homemade as well. I think I found back the picture. I will share it on the Facebook fan page later on today if I manage to have it displayed here. So I guess I'm not that good at controlling my cell phone anymore.
I don't want to know.
Well, it's like, yeah, we are never good with your cell phone, especially typing with the keyboard. I know what you mean. Okay, so maybe that's not gonna be the best quality, but this was how the PC looked like. Oh yeah, that's terrible. That's terrible. Wait. So let's use a webcam to show a picture with the cell phone without even speaking. Anyway, I will post that on the Facebook fan page after that. Okay, there was some question from Lul KOC. What do you guys think about the thermal compound and crack on cold? Is there any solution coming? So let's explain what the issue is, because that's only targeting a very small part of the market.
So I assume that he's talking about the cracks you get when you go too low in temperature. There's not really a solution for it. There's a couple of thermal pastes which allow for a lower temperature before cracking. And there's also a couple of ways where you can prepare your thermal paste in a certain way that you also reduce the temperature before it cracks. But ultimately, a cracking can always occur.
And the cracking is something quite new trend of discussion among extreme overclockers, because that's not something we did experience before, or maybe we did experience it but didn't pay attention to it.
Yeah.
So it became like a big topic of discussion quite fast when we first heard about that. And
I remember that the guys from Team AU were discussing, they were using two thermal probes. One of them was located next to the CPU, and one was located right on top of the, or inside the base, basically. And they only told us a couple of years after that everyone else figured out the cracking, but they said, you know, they figured out that once you see a big delta between the CPU temperature and the base delta, and the copper base of your pot, that's when you have a cracking situation and you need to do a remount.
And the cracking basically the thermal paste is so cold that it's actually crack and create a layer. Actually, it's not touching on each side anymore. It's like it's like fissuring and there's air in between, and that's not gonna be good for the conductivity. That's one of the trends that is being discussed lately for that. Peter, I want to ask you a question and you can answer it with your personal opinion, or you can even just say no. What do you think about this non-K overclocking CPU like that can be overclocked now, and that some manufacturers have BIOS for it, but it's not the official one that you can find? Do you think that's going to be helping people that have not the money and the budget to buy a KSQ to go back to overclocking?
It's a very complex topic. First of all, do I think that a lot of people will go for a non-K CPU because they don't want to pay for a K1? No. The drawbacks there are with non-K overclocking are too big for it to be effectively used for daily computing, I think. Where we might see a rise in usage is the Core i3s, only because the Core i3 does not have a KSQ to begin with. So in i5 and i7s, we have a KSQ, so we can have overclocking without all the drawbacks of no IGP, no thermal controls, or very poor AVX performance. What do I think about the BIOSes, beta BIOSes? Great, awesome. Good that all the motherboard vendors are putting those out in public. I don't see those beta BIOSes also make it to production BIOS, because for sure Intel does not like the situation. They don't like the fact that their KSQs are sort of getting attacked, because their KSQs are a very profitable business for Intel. I saw BioStar and ASRock turn it into a marketing feature, which was surprising. I saw that ASRock already retracted a part of their feature where they announced that they would offer non-K overclocking on H and B chipsets, and they now say that they will not support it, so only on the Z overclocking. So that's pretty interesting. I think for Intel, this is a very good opportunity to have a look at the effect of having an overclockable Core i3 on their Core i5 sales. Because talking to Intel, the main reason why they never did a Core i3K is because they were scared that it would affect their Core i5
like
processor sales.
Business-wise, it makes sense. You don't want to release something that is too cheap and can have extremely good performance to actually eat all the margin and the sales that you have in the upper segment. Yeah. But that's one of the reasons why the biggest Core i7 is a KSQ. You don't want to have like the low end of the i7 to be a KSQ, because everyone will be buying this one and overclock it to get the sales with the other
one. Because the Core i3 already has 4 threads, just like the same like the Core i5, right? So overclocking your 4 threads, you can get very close or even above i5 performance. Anyway, I think this might very well show that people who buy the Core i3 or people who buy the Core i5 will not all of a sudden go back to a Core i3 and overclock it to match their Core i5 performance. Core i5 customer is a Core i5 customer. People who buy Core i3 will buy Core i3. That's just how it is. That's the market segmentation. Yeah, so hopefully what Intel learns from this is the fact that, hey, you know what? We can make a Core i3 KSQ. And that is honestly what I think is going to happen. And you say, okay, you know what? We realize that Core i3 overclocking is popular with a certain group. We want to make money off that, so we'll make a Core i3K, which is a $20 premium on the most expensive Core i3 CPU. That's what I think is going to happen. I hope not. I think it's very nice to currently be able to overclock with a Core i3 6100, like the cheapest Core i3, but
yeah, we will see, because maybe all these non-KSQ overclocking will be fixed by like a microcode update or some BIOS update in the future.
On that topic, yes, it's fixable by a microcode update. Absolutely. There is no doubt about it. It's very easy, in fact. The problem is that when Intel fixes the microcode, they have to push it through the vendors. So any vendor can say, I don't want to have the updated microcode, I'm not going to push it on my BIOSes. Also, as an end user, you can say, I don't want to have the new microcode. I want to use my beta BIOSes. Yeah. So for Intel, there's no leverage to push updated microcode on Skylake. For Kaby Lake, however, which is their upcoming, basically the new talk of Skylake, sort of the Skylake refresh, coming rumored by the end of the year, they can ask, or I think they can ask the motherboard vendors to update the microcode to support Kaby Lake, which also
includes include the microcode update for the previous one.
Whether or not they're going to do that is another topic. I'm not sure.
There's a lot of rumors and actually things that are unsure on how this will be handled by both Intel and the motherboard manufacturers. So far, I don't think there's on the market right now a motherboard that officially support except the Supermicro one. The Supermicro one is the only one that officially support non-K SKU overclocking.
On the H motherboard.
On the H series of chipset. So what I do think personally is that it will become streamlined on the Z170 chipset, but not on the others, because I don't understand why. I will not see why Intel will allow that on the B chipset that are for business and the Q4 integrated system and the H that they don't want. They definitely don't want to have the H170 and the others chipset to support that. But the Z170 chipset will definitely make sense for that. That's going to be like a little bit of the premium sales for allowing that.
Very important to note is that Intel is a company to make money. Like they're not a charity.
There's a business.
Whatever affects the bottom line.
They will, of course, make sure what makes business sense for them. Peter, do you want to discuss something else? Do you have a news you want to share? Something you saw on the internet before going to bed, or if you had some times around workshop, I don't guess so.
None of the stuff I read or watched that before going to bed is can be
no,
on this
no
stream.
No details, please. No details. it's not PG-14. Well, guys, I think that's going to be it for tonight. Thanks you guys for being there, and we will see you guys tomorrow. Tomorrow we will have the first VOC show of the season. That's going to be tomorrow. Yeah, that's going to be tomorrow. The first VOC show of the season. Let me put out the schedule for you guys. So the first OC show will be at 5 p.m. local time here. So that's GMT minus 2. So be there in your local time. You can always go on overclocking-tv.com to find out the right time zone for your city. And be there. We're going to have some guests from UK attending, and we'll be talking about all the latest trend and news in the hardware industry and the overclocking world. Thank you, Peter, for this live show. I think we can actually wrap up the show for tonight. And just gonna go get some more water and go back to sleep, because tomorrow there's gonna be a very long day. That's gonna be the last full day of the workshop before the final for the amateurs on Friday afternoon.
So tomorrow is Wednesday, so there's two more full days.
No way. Did I say 27? Oh, damn it. No, that's just for the amateur. So the amateurs, there's only two more days, huh?
Yeah. So tomorrow and then one more day. So it's not the last final day.
Oh, damn it. Okay. Well, go check the schedule. And be there with us tomorrow for the OC show at 5 p.m. local time. Be there on the 29th all the afternoon for the final for the amateur. We'll be commenting in both English and Portuguese. And the World Series final, the local qualifier here, will be streamed live on the 30th from 1 p.m. local time. That's going to be a little bit more advanced in the day. So a lot of guys from Europe will be able to join and watch that. That's going to be cool.
All right, cool.
Well, thank you guys for being here. And don't forget that until next time, you can keep pushing it.